love and greetings to each one of you from Yogoda Ashrams. Welcome to this discourse, which is fourth in a series of talks on the wisdom of Bhagavad Gita as interpreted by Paramahansa Yogananda in his book God Talks With Arjuna. In the first talk, Yogananda clearly pointed out that we lost our divine kingdom in the game of delusion. To regain that divinity, a Kurukshetra war is going on within each one of us, as our good tendencies and bad tendencies oppose each other. Siding with good tendencies would lead us to lasting happiness and eventually self-realization. Let me read Guruji's words on this point. Each person has to fight his own battle of Kurukshetra. It is a war not only worth winning, but in the divine order of the universe and of the eternal relationship between the soul and God, a war that sooner or later must be won. That is the assurance he is giving, that this is a war each one of us will win, because that is the cosmic design. That is the wish of God. Sooner or later. Let it be sooner. And Guruji also gives another assurance. As God talked with Arjuna, so will he talk with you. As he lifted up the spirit and consciousness of Arjuna, so will he uplift you. As he granted Arjuna supreme spiritual vision, so will he confer enlightenment on you. With this background, we studied the first sloka of the first chapter in Gita. The first sloka tells us a fundamental truth, that life is a series of battles between good and evil, knowledge and ignorance, soul and body, self-control and temptation and the like. It's constantly going on. And the advice given to us by Vedavyasa is that a devotee each night should honestly introspect, like Sanjay was describing what was happening on the battlefield to blind King Dhritarashtra. Our introspection should reveal to our mind how our bad tendencies and good tendencies were on that day. We have to introspect each day. It is not that we want to know what we have done. More importantly, we want to know why we did what we did. What is the purpose? What is the motive behind our actions? That is also important if we are to progress spiritually. That is the import of the first sloka. The second sloka gives us a warning. How our past bad habits try to dissuade when we start spiritual practices. Thus we find the second verse of the Gita forewarning the spiritual aspirant that King Duryodhana, material desire, will try to arouse man's Drona, sense habit tendencies, to fight against the soul forces of discrimination. An ordinary person, knowing nothing about the supreme joy that can come out of meditation, innocently reconciles himself to sense pleasures. Whatever he can get through tongue, eyes, ears, he is happy. But once he starts meditating and he finds that there is so much more in this meditation, then the king material desire inside, which was always depending on the senses for its pleasures, gets alarmed. Oh, this fellow now going towards meditation. That means I would be denied of my joys which I was getting from all the senses all along. So he would turn towards Dronacharya, past habit, to discourage the devotee from meditating. That's why we find that whenever we sit in meditation, especially in the beginning, we get so many reminders of the unfinished jobs to dissuade us from meditating. Oh, you have to make a telephone call. That incomplete job, first right now finish and then you can meditate peacefully. Others are waiting for dinner. You are tired. Tomorrow you can see. Like that, various thoughts come to discourage the person. Even those persons with resolute, you know, effort, sit for meditation, then the past habit of sleepiness, thoughts, all these things also try to dissuade him. So this is the warning given to us. Beware, beware. Discouragement doesn't necessarily come from outside, others disturbing us. Discouragement comes from within most of the time. But there is hope. Because Dronacharya was not only the teacher of Kauravas, he was also the teacher of Pandavas. The habit could be good also. Habit do not mean they are always bad. They could be good. So take advantage of the good habits, same Dronacharya, to help us in our pursuit of higher goals. So Dronacharya we can somehow cultivate, because in the heart of hearts, Dronacharya wanted victory to Pandavas, although by force of circumstances, he had to fight on behalf of Kauravas. So what is Dronacharya in our spiritual practices? Regularity, habit. That's a good habit, good side of Dronacharya. So form that regular habit, you know, habit of meditating regularly, then we will win the war. Dronacharya is on our side. Next, we studied the third sloka. It gives a clue how to win our bad habits. And the summary of the sloka is here. Thus, it is explained in this verse that when material desire and his army of sense tendencies and their restless thoughts try to reinforce themselves by past material habit in order to dissuade the spiritual aspirant from the practice of meditation, they find that the calm inner light of awakening intuition, well trained in meditation by past spiritual habit, has effectively arrayed the discriminative faculties to give metaphysical resistance. And it's very simple to understand, although sentences are too long. By nature, every devotee has that inner urge to progress spiritually by sadhana. Like every student would like to study daily in order to have a prosperous career later. But unfortunately, the habits of procrastination, laziness, the tendency to have instant sense pleasures, you know, instant gratification of senses, they oppose our good inclinations. This sloka explains how to get over those evil tendencies within us. Ultimately, it is that calm inner light of intuitive awakening only can destroy bad habits. What does it mean? Intuitive awakening. That it's not only the conviction, but intuitive. It can intuit and see the worthlessness of going ahead with this bad habit in future. It can see the future intuitively. This is not going to help me. So that conviction has to come inside intuitively, then it can be destroyed. Because in the calm inner light of intuitive awakening is represented by Drustajumna, who was the commander-in-chief of Pandava army. And eventually, he is the one who killed Dronacharya, the habit. So he could kill Dronacharya because intuitive awakening can only get rid of the habits. But how can we develop that intuitive awakening? Drustajumna came out of fire after intense tapas done by his father Drupada. Similarly, the awakening comes by spiritual practices. When we do regularly meditation, then that awakening gradually comes, that intuitive awakening, through which we can destroy our bad habits. Then we took the study of slokas 4, 5 and 6 in the last talk. These slokas tells us something. Pandavas, 5 of them, alone could not win the war, Kurukshetra. They needed the support of many allies. Many supporters were there who helped them to win the war, like Virat, Drupad, Kashiraja, Kunti Bhoja, Purujit, Shaibya. All these kings helped them, Pandavas, to win the war. Similarly, my pranayam, my self-control and calmness are not adequate, no, to win this internal Kurukshetra and find self-realization. I also need help of many other qualities like spiritual memory, discriminative intelligence, devotion. All these qualities I require. These qualities are spiritual effects gathered by a devotee by practice of yoga meditation. Meaning that one need not necessarily be born with these divine qualities like devotion, spiritual memory, sraddha, prajna, discrimination, vairagya. Not necessarily. They come with birth. We can cultivate them. As we are doing sadhana, these qualities come to surface and eventually they come to our aid in fighting this internal Kurukshetra. Today, we'll take up slokas 7 and 8. Before that, let's first listen to the sloka sung by Swami Vasudevananji.
अस्माकं तु विशिष्टाये तान्नि बोध द्विजोत्तम नायका मम सैन्यस्य संज्ञार्थं तान् ब्रवीमि ते भवान् भीष्मश्च कर्णश्च कृपश्च समितिञ्जयः अश्वत्थामा विकर्णश्च सौम्यदत्ति जयद्रथः अस्माकं तु विशिष्टाये तान्निबोध द्विजोत्तम नायका मम सैन्यस्य संज्ञार्थं तान् ब्रवीमि ते भवान् भीष्मश्च कर्णश्च कृपश्च समितिञ्जयः अश्वत्थामा विकर्णश्च सौम्यदत्ति जयद्रथः.
The plain meaning of the seventh sloka goes like this, as given by Gurudeva Paramahansaji. Duryodhana continues, "Listen to, O flower of the twice born, best of the Brahmins, about the generals of my army who are prominent amongst ourselves. These I speak about now for thine information." Recall that from sloka 3 to 6, Duryodhana, having surveyed the army of Pandavas, explained that the various warriors standing there to fight on behalf of Pandavas. And Guruji has given the explanation, the spiritual soldiers they are in our cerebrospinal centers to help the devotee. After identifying the Pandava warriors, now Duryodhan identifies the Kaurava warriors and names them to his guru Dronacharya, who they are. And eighth sloka, "These warriors are thyself," meaning Dronacharya, "Bhishma, Karna, Krupa, victors in battles, Aswadhaman, Vikarna, Somadatti, and Jayadratha." These are the warriors ready to fight for me. And what are the characteristics of these warriors? What do they represent? Dronacharya represents habit. Bhishma, ego. Karna, attachment, meaning raga. Krupacharya, individual delusion. Aswadhama, latent desire. Vikarna, repulsion. Somadatti, material action. Jayatrata, body bound inclination. These are the eight warriors, and these are the inclinations they represent. Obviously, they are all evil inclinations. They are there in us. These frailties and weaknesses that have become one's comfortable second nature. They have become second nature. Sometimes we don't even realize, because they have become part of our consciousness, unfortunately. And the first thing is to realize, identify them, and try to work them out of our system. Here, there is perfect analogy with Patanjali Yoga Sutras. We have seen that the good tendencies in us, they perfectly correlate with the tendencies given in Patanjali Yoga Sutras, they correlate very well. Here, even the negative tendencies are also mentioned in Patanjali Yoga Sutras. Yoga Sutra 24 in chapter 1 of Patanjali Yoga Sutras reads like this. Patanjali says, "The Lord is untouched by klesha," meaning trouble, "karma," action, "vipaka," habit, "ashaya," desire, meaning Lord is beyond these qualities, troubles, action, habit, and desire, he doesn't have. In another Yoga Sutra, Sutra 3 in second chapter, the klesha, that's trouble, is defined as fivefold, avidya, meaning ignorance, asmita, meaning ego, raga, attachment, dvesha, aversion, abhinivesha, body attachment. So thus, here there are eight qualities are mentioned which Lord is untouched by. Meaning, Lord doesn't have these defects. these imperfections are completely away from God. Like material action and habit and desire, ignorance, ego, attachment, repulsion, he doesn't have. What is that we are looking for in our life? Self-realization or lasting happiness. Aham Brahmasmi, meaning I am God, I am a spark of divinity. If I am divine, I must be having all the qualities of God in me. What are the qualities of God? Love, joy, wisdom, compassion, forgiveness. These are the qualities of Lord. So all these qualities I must have. Similarly, God doesn't have certain qualities like ego, habit, desires, attachment, repulsion. These qualities God doesn't have. So I also should be free from these imperfections if I were to become God. Now, Aham Brahmasmi is the fundamental truth. I am divine. If so, I must be having these good qualities in me, and I must be having none of these bad qualities. But if I honestly look within, I have these imperfections in me. I have desire, repulsion, attachment, likes, dislikes, all this I have. Then the question is, are you going to get rid of these imperfections when you become God? Or you become God when you get rid of these imperfections? Did you get the question? These imperfections will go away from you when you become God, or you become God when you get rid of these imperfections? Did you get the question? The answer is clear. My sadhana means I have to get rid of these imperfections in me. When these imperfections are out of my system, my consciousness, then I am that close to divinity. So sadhana means that. Once Swami Bhavananji said, in one sentence he defined sadhana: seeking God means expressing God. That means if I say that I am a devotee, I am seeking God, means I must be expressing God in my daily life. That means I must be expressing love. I must express joy, forgiveness, compassion, wisdom. These things I should express in my life. At the same time, I should not have any imperfections like ego, raga, dvesha, attachment, repulsion, desires. These things I should not have. That is what is meant by sadhana. Until we express God in our daily life, we are not really sadhaks. At least we must be making that effort to express Lord in our daily life. That is the sadhana. Remember that seeking God means expressing God. That is why when we are really good devotee, others are positively benefited, positively impacted, because you are expressing God. You don't have these imperfections. You are full of love, devotion, joy, compassion. Then people feel that. Let that be our aim. Expressing God in our daily life. Then we can say that I am seeking God. Not only for sake of God, achieving God's self-realization, even for lasting happiness, we must live like that. If you have these imperfections, ego, delusion, desires, raga, dvesha, then we can't be happy in life. Now, we'll take up these qualities one by one. I try to understand. The first warrior is Krupacharya. It represents avidya, meaning individual delusion. In spiritual literature, there are two words which are used rather interchangeably: delusion and illusion. They are used sometimes interchangeably, but there is some subtle difference. Delusion is something universal that affects everyone. But illusion is something which affects only particular persons, not universal. Example, I am this body. That's delusion, because not only me, almost everyone thinks that I am this body. That's delusion, universal. But if someone says that it's impossible to live without taking so many cups of coffee every day, it's impossible to live. No man can live. If someone has that conviction, means he is in illusion. Because other people don't think that way. But he has come to that understanding that it is impossible to live without so many cups of coffee or whatever. So that is illusion. Kripacharya represents that illusion, individual delusion. Classical example is this, Rajju Sarpa Bhranti. Bhranti means illusion, Rajju means rope, Sarpa means snake. Suppose two persons are walking, there is a rope on the ground. One person may take it as snake and may step back, because he sees that a snake, steps back. Other person walking with him in the same direction, under the same light, he doesn't. He sees rope a rope. But other person may take it as a snake and he may step back. That is illusion. Rajju Sarpa Bhranti. Other person is not. So that is the difference between illusion and delusion. Another example I can give is this. Two women were good friends. When they came of age, they got married and they parted. They lived separately for many, many years. They happened to meet again after some 30 years. They were exchanging the notes, what happened in each other's lives. So one woman asked the other, I heard that your son is married, how is he doing? Then immediately that person said, other one, oh, what should I say? My son is married, but a very bad marriage, inharmonious marriage. His wife is not at all cooperative. His wife doesn't cook, doesn't clean, doesn't wash, doesn't do anything. She is always in her bedroom reading books of her choice. And even bed tea has to be given in her room. Poor fellow, he is not at all enjoying. Oh, really unfortunate and inharmonious marriage. After some time, the woman asks another question. I understand that your daughter also is married. How is she doing? When she asked, her face lit up. She said, oh, my daughter is married. Now she is leading a very happy, exemplary, harmonious life. Now she doesn't have to cook. She doesn't have to clean. She doesn't have to wash. All the time she is in her bedroom reading books of her choice. Even tea is given in her bedroom. Very happy, exemplary, ideal marriage she is leading. Do you understand that? Am I making up a story? Don't we see this around? That means this woman is not able to distinguish good and bad. She wants daughter should be like this. She wants daughter-in-law should be like this. I mean, that is illusion, avidya, illusion. Whereas we can all see, all of us can see that, what is this woman? She wants her daughter to be like this, she wants her daughter-in-law to be the other way. We can see, but she is not able to see because of attachment, of her, that bad inclination actually, thinking pattern. That is illusion. Whereas we all can see very clearly, not she. Patanjali Yoga Sutras, 5th Sutra from chapter 2 reads, ignorance is perceiving the non-eternal to be eternal, impure to be pure, evil to be good, what is not soul to be the soul. That is avidya. By delusive imagination, man creates his own illusions of reality and brings them into being. Guruji wrote, "Thus man is a miniature creator, fashioning good or evil for himself and the phenomenon world, of which he is an operative part. It is this creative force inherent in man's thoughts that makes them so formidable. The truth in the adage, thoughts are things, should be duly respected." I mean, wonderful explanation. Avidya, when a person is in that illusion, he doesn't realize. Guruji goes on saying, the influence of the force of avidya, illusion, is such that no matter how irksome the illusion, deluded man is loath to part with it. That woman, distinguishing between daughter and daughter-in-law, doesn't want to part with that concept, although that must be creating some inharmony in the family. You know, others see that, they comment, they are irksome and inharmony, but still she is loath to part with that concept. Daughter should be like this, daughter-in-law should be like this. I mean, that is the thing. And Guruji goes on saying very nicely, man fabricates his own standards of morality and behavior and calls them good, irrespective of their disharmony with eternal divine law. Isn't it a very good example, daughter and daughter-in-law? Here, man fabricates his own standards of morality and behavior and calls them good. Not only good, he says that others must follow this. Doesn't realize. I mean, who is that man in that illusion? That is none other than you and me. It's not only that woman, we can very easily see that woman, but sometimes even I can see that. How could I think that way? Although it's not in harmony with the divine laws, but still I want things like that way. That is illusion. That's illusion. Okay. Kripacharya, we have to conquer him, because as long as this illusion is there, individual delusion, avidya, we can't be happy. We can't be anywhere close to self-realization. Now, there is one trick here. At the end of Kurukshetra war, three Kaurava warriors survived. Most of them were annihilated. Bhishma, Drona, Duryodhana, Dushyasana, Karna, Vikarna, all of them were annihilated. Except three, they didn't die. One of them was Kripacharya. Other two, Ashwatthama and Krutavarma. These three warriors survived. Now, does it mean that even after self-realization, this individual delusion, avidya, illusion is not going to leave me? I am going to be eternally in that illusion? It should not be understood that way. When self-realization happens, it is to be understood that the individuality doesn't fade. Individuality, that identity, remains. To explain this, I would like to take an example. Oftentimes, ocean is referred to as God and wave as soul. No, God, ocean is spirit and wave is soul, individual soul, whereas that is God. But this is not 100% correct. It gives an idea of soul and spirit, but not 100% true, in the sense that when a wave comes out of ocean, it dances for some time as if it has got an individual existence, and it dances. After some time, the wave goes back. It merges with ocean. That wave is gone. And next, another wave comes. Will we ever say that the same wave has returned? We never say that. Wave has some existence, No doubt, independence has, that identity is there, of wave, we can see that, but it got merged, that's it, it's gone. Another wave comes, not the same wave. But this is not true with our souls. Soul, once it comes out of God, it plays many roles, incarnation after incarnation, but never loses its identity, its individuality, even after merging with God. Even after self-realization, still that identity is maintained in God, in spirit. That's why we hear, even after realization, some saints come back. We say that saint has come back because that individuality is maintained. That is Krupacharya. So, in that sense, Krupacharya survived, but he didn't trouble anymore. That individuality may be there, but it's no more of any trouble to the soul. Merged once with God, that individual may see all his lives, so many incarnations, he may remember all that, but he never loses that identity. That's all right. So, even if he survived, he is not going to trouble you and trouble me. Remember one thing. That we are all here now, in this incarnation, this is what you are, what I am. Even after this, maybe after, and you and I, merge with God, still we can talk to each other. Oh, that day. Because that individuality is there, remember. That we never lose. So, we'll maintain this connection later also. Even with our close people, it is there always, it is there. Okay, that is the first warrior. We have to get rid of individual delusion, avidya, illusion. Otherwise, if you don't make Krupacharya powerless, he is going to trouble us again and again. We will be again in the same mood, daughter and daughter-in-law mood. So, we have to conquer that individual delusion. Next warrior, Bhishma, the powerful Bhishma. He stands for ego, aham, ahankar. Any time we hear the word ahankar or ego, it gives a negative connotation. Isn't it true? That ego means negative connotation. But it need not be so. It need not be so. No, I-ness is there. When the soul merely uses the instruments of this body and mind as means to communicate and interact with the world outside, it's not a problem. The soul is using this body and this mind as merely means to communicate with this external world. That soul is not in that ahankar mode, because it doesn't identify so much with this body. I am this body, I am this mind, these are my thoughts, I, that's not there. But soul, in that joyous mood of love and joy, you know, it uses this body, it uses this mind, then it's not really negative ego. This was beautifully explained by Guruji in the book God Talks With Arjuna. Let me read out. He said, when identified with gross senses and their objects, the I-ness becomes the wisdom-destroying physical ego. No, when I-ness, I is there, sense of I is there in me as it is in you, the I-ness identifies itself with gross senses and the sensory objects, sensory pleasures, then this I-ness becomes the wisdom-destroying physical ego. That is what we don't want. That is destroying our wisdom, because it thinks that this is all body. I am this body. I identify so much. Next, Guruji says, when identified with the subtle instruments of perception and knowledge in the astral body, the I-ness becomes a clearer sense of being, the astral ego. one step above, this I-ness identifies not with this body, but the subtle instruments of perception and knowledge. No, we have already seen in the very first lecture that sense perceptions, life energy belong to astral body. And I don't identify with this body, but the sensory perceptions and the knowledge, if I identify, then it becomes astral ego, not physical ego. Wisdom is not destroyed. It's already has that wisdom that I am not this body, but I am identified with this sensory perceptions, something subtler. Guruji says further, when the I-ness expresses solely through pure intuitive wisdom, the instrument of the causal body, it becomes the pure discriminating ego, the divine ego. So one step even further, when I-ness identifies itself and expresses through intuitive wisdom, which is a faculty of causal body, then it becomes a divine ego. Wisdom destroying physical ego, identifying with body. I am this body, I am this, I am this. Or identifying with the sensory perceptions inside, knowledge, it becomes astral ego. In addition to this knowledge, it's wisdom guided by intuition, and then it becomes divine ego, the causal body. So that is also possible. So ego has its levels, phases. That's why Bhishma very nicely represents this. In him you can see physical ego, you can see him astral ego, you can see divine ego in him. All three you can see if you look into his life story. The Hindu scriptures say, when this I shall die, then will I know who am I. When this I shall die, then will I know who am I. This is not a simple tongue twister. There is depth in this, deep meaning is there in this. To explain this, I would like to take this example of Bhishma. Bhishma, no doubt, represents ego. One question, who killed Bhishma? Think about it. Who killed Bhishma? The answer could be, Bhishma was killed by Arjuna. Or some say, Bhishma was killed by Shikhandi. Or some might say, Bhishma was killed by Krishna. But the highest truth is, Bhishma was killed by Bhishma. Do you understand that? Bhishma was killed by Bhishma because he had that gift of, you know, inviting his death whenever he wanted. Icha marana varagrahita. Icha marana. He could invite his own death whenever he wanted. So eventually he invited. What happened during the Kurukshetra war? 9 days he fought on behalf of Kauravas. Killed so many people. And after that, he gave up. When Pandavas were very resolute, and he could see that, yes, now is the time, he revealed to Pandavas the way to conquer him. He said, bring a woman in front of me in the war, I will leave my astras, my weapons, I'll leave. So he becomes weaponless. Then Shikhandi was brought in, Arjuna could win him. So he revealed, and later after so many days, he invited death and departed from this world. And analogy is this. Here is my ego, okay. And what do I want? Self-realization. Who wants the self-realization? I. That aham, actually. I want self-realization. What is meant by self-realization? dissolving ego. That means my ego wants to dissolve the ego to find self-realization. Isn't it true? So eventually, my ego wants to destroy the ego consciousness so that it can have that God realization. So it's a perfect example. We cannot miss the point. One more minor example I can give is this. I meditate. What is the purpose of meditation? Again, my ultimate goal is self-realization. That means I want to dissolve my I-ness, my ego. But who is meditating? Ego. My ego is helping me to annihilate my physical ego. The ego is trying to help me, ego, to annihilate ego. I mean, that's why the Sindhu scriptures say that when this I shall die, then will I know who am I. So the physical ego, astral ego have to go. Then divine ego survives. That is the meaning of Ichha Varana, Ichha Marana Varagrahita. So you and I have that capacity. And that's what we are doing actually in meditation. I want to meditate to dissolve this ego consciousness. Who is meditating? My ego. Do you see the analogy now? And eventually, with God's grace and Guru's blessings, it's going to happen. It's going to happen in degrees. Eventually, I'm going to dissolve this ego with the help of ego. Like Bhishma was vanquished by Bhishma. Next, another point. Again, it relates to me and relates to you. Is why Bhishma had to go. Why he was killed eventually. Why? This we have seen in the very first talk also. Bhishma was one of the most venerable personalities in Mahabharata. Everyone had and even now have, everyone has that so much reverence for Bhishma, venerable personality. But even he had to go. Why? In spite of all his good things, in spite of the powerful person he was, he had one defect, one shortcoming, one imperfection, that he always wanted all his children, both Kauravas and Pandavas, to live in peace. It's not wrong to desire so. My children, Pandavas and Kauravas, should live in peace. There's nothing wrong in that desire. But when he was seeing Kauravas erring again and again and again, making mistakes, troubling Pandavas, then he kept quiet. He didn't do anything. If only he wanted to punish the culprit, punish the guilty, he could have annihilated the entire erring Kaurava clan with one arrow. He was that powerful, that capable. But he didn't. At no point he punished Kauravas. All along he wanted Kauravas and Pandavas to live together. Even after war started also, when there was no scope for peace, even then he wanted and started fighting for Kauravas with the intention that there will be some peace. That is why he had to go. See, same thing with me, that ego in me wants to cultivate good inclinations like meditation, devotion, love, compassion, forgiveness, even-mindedness. All these things I am cultivating. These are Pandavas in me. At the same time, I also have some Kauravas in me, that laziness, pride, that jealousy, desires, greed, raga, dvesha, all these, they are also in me. So I don't want to leave them, but I want God. I want Pandavas and Kauravas together in me, good inclinations, bad inclinations, and at the same time I want God. It doesn't work. Bhishma had to go. After Bhishma was out, Then Dronacharya was killed, and then Karna was vanquished, and then others, one by one, Shalya, Duryodhan, everyone. But as long as ego was there, Bhishma, the Pandavas couldn't proceed much further, farther, they couldn't go far. Same thing with me, the ego has to be subsided. It has to subside in me. Then only there is hope. Any egoistic person, very difficult, very difficult. Okay, that is second warrior. Bhishma we have to get rid of. Pandavas also faced a lot of problems with Bhishma as long as he was alive on the field. Okay. Third warrior, Karna. He represents attachment, raga. Guruji writes, Karna signifies the propensity for pursuing material action towards which there is natural attachment because of enjoyment or pleasure derived from it. Karna represents Patanjali's raga. In Yoga Sutra 7 of 2nd chapter, raga is that inclination dwells on pleasure. So, raga dvesha means likes and dislikes are attachment and repulsion. This attachment, raga is represented by Karna, repulsion, dislike is represented by Vikarna. Karna or raga then is the principle in the deluded man that causes him to seek that work or action to which he is attached because of the pleasure it gives him. And he justifies that action by proclaiming it to be his duty. Thus, whatever he wants to do, because of his attachment to it, he can rationalize as necessary and right. Okay. Now, if you take a look at the life of Karna, this point becomes very clear. We want to have a good understanding of Karna because we want to eliminate that Karna from us. The Karna is there sitting here. So, we want to eliminate. So, let's understand the role of karma in Mahabharata. See, Karna, again for some reason, he sided with Duryodhan because Duryodhan gave him some status when he was in dire need of it. He was no one otherwise, son of a charioteer. So, he had to take the help of Duryodhan to have some status. What was his desire? What was that to which he was attached? One over-consuming desire to prove that I am superior to Arjuna. That was the attachment he always had, that desire to prove that I am superior to Arjuna. That was the only thing, and that has brought him to Duryodhan. And all along he says that I am loyal to Duryodhan, I am loyal to Duryodhan. But that is not so much because of his interest in the welfare of Duryodhan. It's because the opportunity Duryodhan gave him to prove his superiority over Arjuna. It was not that friendship towards Duryodhan that was the driving force. It was the attachment to his own goal. In fact, Karna was a wise man. He has always been seeing Duryodhan making mistakes. In fact, he was a party to it. But never he prevented Duryodhan from making mistakes, dire mistakes, because of his attachment to his own desire. Bhagavan Krishna went to Hastinapur with a peace mission. He wanted to bring peace between Kauravas and Pandavas and avert the war. But the peace mission failed. After the failure of the mission, Bhagavan Krishna reveals his identity, true identity, Karna You are not the son of a charioteer. You are actually son of Kunti. You are the eldest son of Kunti, brother of Pandavas. And it is time for you to leave Duryodhan and go to Pandavas. And that will help to bring peace. And this is your, this is what you are truly. You are a Pandava, not someone who has to support Kauravas. Karna said that, no, it is my duty to protect and support Duryodhan, who gave me so much in life. He was in a predicament. He cried, why, creator, why did you put me in this position? Why did you put me in this position? He cried and cried. He couldn't take the advice of Bhagavan Krishna. That's understandable, because Bhagavan Krishna was known as Pandava Pakshapati. He was always favoring Pandavas. He was on their side. Okay, he is partial to them. It's okay. You don't have to take his advice. But in that predicament, to resolve the issue, Karna could have approached his guru Parshuram or Vedavyas. They were wise men of the time. Wise. Parshuram or Vedavyas. He could have gone to them and explained this. This is the situation. What should I do? What is the right thing for me? He didn't approach them. He didn't go to Parshuram, his guru. He didn't go to Vedavyas. Because he was afraid of their advice. That advice may go against his own attachment to his desire to prove that I am superior to Arjuna. Just because of that, he couldn't go. And he stayed on, fought for Duryodhan. And this overwhelming attachment to his goal eventually brought his downfall, and that of his friend Duryodhan and many others. Maybe if Karna relented, left his attachment and revealed openly, this is what I am, this is what I have to do, go to Pandavas, Kurukshetra war could have been averted, possibly. No? The attachment is so strong, it kills him, it kills others. But this same thing with you and with me also. Sometimes we are so much attached to one little desire, to one little goal in life, and we forget the bigger picture. If only you wanted the welfare of Duryodhan, you could have avoided the war. He was saying, this war will not be won by Kauravas. He was saying that, but still he went on with the war. Because he was not interested in the welfare of his friend Duryodhan. Although he says, always he has been saying that, I am loyal to him. Okay, next. Vikarna. Vikarna represents repulsion. Dvesha. Raga, dvesha. Like and dislike. Karna, vikarna. Attachment, repulsion. Guruji wrote, vikarna means one who behaves according to his natural tendency in avoiding actions that do not give pleasure, that are disagreeable. It's just the opposite. Karna always wanted to do certain things because of his attachment of the pleasure that is likely to give. And Vikarna wants to avoid things which are likely to be not giving pleasure. Man's ignorance distorts the sense of right and wrong, good and evil, and creates in him the dual opposites of likes and dislikes, raga dvesha. Guruji writes, he is attached to what he likes and avoids what he dislikes, rather than exercising discriminative free choice and following what is truly right and best for him. This is very easy to understand in our own lives. One simple example I give is this. Why people neglect even essential actions like walking for health? Now, doctor advises you have regular walks. It is important for you, for your health. This is standard advice we hear, but people don't go for a walk. It repels you, because that walking for half an hour or 1 hour doesn't give them so much joy. It doesn't give any happiness. It doesn't give any pleasure. So they want to avoid. Whereas the same 1 hour, he is very happy to spend in front of TV. Whatever the program, he just keeps on, surrenders to TV and spends 1 hour. But he doesn't have 1 hour to go for walk. Repulsion towards walking is as simple as that. Something which doesn't give him pleasure. So avoid it. And we are intelligent enough to give explanations to cover up our repulsion. No, because of repulsion I don't want to go, not because I don't have time. There is motivation actually for my health, but still I avoid it. Like this, many other things, in many essential activities. Meditation, for example. Some people start meditation because it's work. Later we'll see in Karma Yoga, third chapter, meditation is intense work. Some people think that it's passive. No, it's intense work. That is why some people, and it doesn't give immediate pleasure what they expect. So they want to avoid. It's a repulsion, vikarnainas. Here is a story. Now, once a person approached a saint and explained his problems. Now my health is going down. I have blood pressure problem. I have diabetes developed. And what should I do? Please give me some advice. The saint heard him and said, from now onwards, you read good books, meditate regularly, and walk for 1 hour every day in the graveyard nearby. Good books, meditation, and walk for 1 hour in the graveyard nearby. This person react, what? Walking for 1 hour in the graveyard? I don't have that kind of time. I cannot spend 1 hour in walking every day. Then the saint replied, if you don't have 1 hour time to spend there in the graveyard now, pretty soon, you will have to spend all your time there. You understand that? If you don't have 1 hour walking time there, pretty soon you have to spend all your time in the graveyard. And he added, and all those who are resting there in the graveyard said the same thing when they were alive. I don't have the time. I don't have the time for walking. I don't have time for meditation. For all these things. Now they are resting permanently there. See, if one is serious and convinced of the need for something, we must go for it. That is your responsibility and my responsibility. Not allow vikarna to dominate us, to take charge of lives. We are convinced we have to go for that. Whatever may be that action, even if it doesn't give pleasure as much as we want, as quickly as we want. It is important, no repulsion here, no vikarna here, I have to go for that. You have to do that. See, karna, vikarna, likes and dislikes, it seems that they have become so much a part of our life. The world conditions us to have these likes and dislikes. It's so much like this. Because they could be very subtle. That's why I'm repeating this. We are very subtle. Sometimes we don't recognize the existence of vikarna in us. Although he is there. Kaurava. Here is another story. Likes and dislikes. Once a very sincere sadhak, spiritual person, a very saintly person, he wanted to watch a football match. A deeply religious person. Now, he was spending so much time in his worship, in his spiritual practices. One day he wanted to see a football match. So he was taken to a stadium where two teams, two very highly professional teams were playing. Team A came from one town, and that town has a presiding deity. You know, some particular form of God was there in the temple. And they went to the temple and worshipped, had the blessings of the deity, and came for this match. Team B was from another town, having some other deity there. You know, another presiding deity was some divine mother or someone was there. They went, took blessings, and they came for the match. So Team A and Team B, belonging to different sort of religious denominations or whatever, they were playing. After some time, Team A scored a goal. And this saintly person sitting there watching, he was so happy. He threw his hands into the air and he was so joyous, so happy at some people were. You know, like an innocent child, he was enjoyed. Okay. After some time, a little later, Team B scored a goal. Then this person again got up from his seat, jumped up and down, very, very happy, expressed his joy. Now the person sitting on his back was wondering, what is this fellow? And he tapped his shoulder and said, hey, whom you are supporting? Team A or Team B? This man said, oh, supporting? No, I am just enjoying the game. I am not supporting anyone. I am just enjoying the skills and the game. And that person commented, this fellow is an atheist. See, this fellow is a saintly person, religious person. He is an atheist. Because the person thinks that person should have some likes and dislikes. Either he should like A or like B. You should belong to this religion or you should belong to that religion. You should denom this denomination and that denomination. This temple, this church. You should have something, some like, some belonging, some dislike. You should have it. I mean, that's how the world is conditioned. But this person was just enjoying the game, the skills that are being displayed. He was just enjoying. That's not acceptable to the world. You have to be. Likes and dislikes have become so much a part of this world. Karna vikarna. I mean, influence. So watch out. Next, Jayatrata. Jayatrata represents body-bound inclination, abhinivesha. Jayatrata represents the subtle tenacity to body attachment and is the correlate to Patanjali's fifth klesha, abhinivesha. This tenacity is a finer or more subtle grade of attachment than the possessiveness man feels for objects or persons. I mean, this is understandable. The way I love my body, the way I have attachment to my body, physical body, is supreme. I mean, that is supreme. I have, you know, I like my body so much. Each one of us. That is body-bound inclination. Western psychologists call it the force of self-preservation and noted that it is the strongest urge in man. I mean, that is fine. It's strongest urge because I am a tenant. I have to take care of it. I have to feel proud of my house. That is fine. But it has got some unnecessary negative side effects. This body-bound inclination not only expresses itself as fear of death, but also gives rise to a host of mortal characteristics and actions contrary to the immortal nature of the true self, like selfishness, possessiveness, the storing up of treasures on earth as though this will be his permanent home. I mean, that is the worst part of it. Getting attached to the body, taking care of it, feeling proud of it, that is all right. I have this nice body, I have to maintain its health, I take advantage of it. I mean, I would like to be always nice. That is fine. But this attachment to body may lead to other things, like one is fear of death. I don't want to lose this body. I mean, that is again natural. That is also permitted. Fear of death, if you have, you will take care of the body. But possessiveness, the storing up of treasures on earth as though this is the permanent home. And we know one philosophy is there that we don't carry our possessions to next incarnation. But at the same time, I want to have more and more and more. I mean, that is body-bound inclination. Definitely, this person has to be killed. Chaitrata eventually was killed by Arjuna. Because that is something you and I have to overcome. Not so much, attached to this body. Not so much. Take care of it. Take advantage of it. But not attached to it as if this is our permanent home. Next, son of Somadatta, he is Somadatti, son of Somadatta, other name is Bhurisravas. He represents material action. Bhurisravas, material action that produces binding effects because it is instigated by egoistic desire, is thus to be conquered by the aspiring yogi, Guruji writes. I mean, material action, which produces binding effects, that is to be avoided. Yoga Sutras say, the actions of a yogi are neither pure nor dark. In others, they are of three kinds, pure, dark, or a mixture of pure and dark, our actions. The works of a yogi who is established in self-realization leaves no impressions, either good or evil, to bind him. I mean, as long as we have existence, life, we are bound to be involved in action. There is no doubt about it. We are all active. We have to be involved in actions. But the actions should be such that they should not bind us with the evil effects of those actions. I mean, with the thought of God, we should perform. They should not bind. The same action, the one example I can give is this. Suppose you are on a seashore. There was someone flying in a helicopter. You have to send a message. You write the message on sand. And he reads that and he gets the message. But on the sand, the message is left behind. It is there. But on the other hand, you write something on the water. And the person sees what you are writing on water. He gets the message. But nothing is left behind. It's all gone. So, same action done in two different ways. One is binding, effects are left behind. Here, it's gone. Similarly, actions when we do with the thought of God, for God, then it doesn't leave that effects which are carried over. Next warrior is Dronacharya. He represents habit, samskara, inner tendency. Patanjali is Vipaka. Drona represents habit, or more precisely, samskara, the impressions made on the consciousness by past thoughts and actions, which create strong tendencies to repeat themselves. We have studied quite a bit of Dronacharya in our previous talks. So let's remember, Dronacharya also was Guru of Pandavas. Habit can also be good. Let's cultivate that good side of Dronacharya. Next, the last warrior mentioned in the Sloka 8, Aswatthama, 8th warrior. He represents Ashaya of Patanjali, meaning latent desire. Paramahansa Yogananda writes, that which remains unchanged and doesn't perish with death is desire, Patanjali's ashaya. More specifically, it is latent desire or desire seed, vasana, or the impressions of desire on the consciousness. Guruji says, in man, this latent desire, aswadhama, should be distinguished from active desire, Duryodhana. Duryodhana represents the desire, active desire. Aswatthama represents latent desire. There is some difference between the two. I would like to explain and then close. Active desire is an impulse of the mind that produces an independent wish. Impulse of the mind, it produces an independent of wish, independent wish. It has nothing to do with any other activity. It just comes out of nowhere, independent wish. And when this impulse arises fresh in the mind, it can be checked or suppressed by a quick act of will. If you have willpower, this, when a desire comes in the mind as an impulse, it can be checked by an act of will and wisdom. Guruji goes on saying, every desire, however, acted on or not, is soon followed by another. Such desires for the gratification of the ego do not cease even when supposedly satisfied. Something always remains unfulfilled. If a desire is satisfied and there is a tendency to have it again and again, the repetition is there because it has given us some pleasure, the desire, repetition. If the desire is not fulfilled, there is also strong urge to get it fulfilled somehow because it is there, unfulfilled desire. Every unfulfilled active desire, unless roasted by wisdom, plants a new desire seed in the mind. This is more dangerous. Unfulfilled desire, if it is not cleared by wisdom, because it was not cleared by fulfillment, it is unfulfilled. But unfulfilled, we have to clear it by wisdom. These desire seeds are more compelling than the impulsive fresh desires, deeply rooting themselves in the subconscious, ready to spring up suddenly with demands that are most often unreasonable, frustrating and sorrow producing. As desire begets desires, the only way to end the cycle is to destroy the causes. Now, we have to understand this. Desire fulfilled, again there is a tendency to have it again and again because of the pleasure it gives. Desire unfulfilled, there is an urge to get it fulfilled. Either way, if it is not repeatedly fulfilled or if it is the unfulfilled one, if it is not satisfied, it sows some seeds. That is there inside. The seed is there, unfulfilled desire. I want this to happen, it didn't happen. That's unfulfilled, it is there. And we don't realize that, we don't notice that. It is inside, but it springs up. Suddenly, sometimes it springs up. Almost no impulse, nothing has caused it. It comes out, it's more frustrating because we don't even understand why I have this desire. Why it is coming up? It more compelling and more frustrating because neither you have control nor there is fulfillment. These are the things we have to be very careful about. Latent desire. Sometimes suddenly something comes into mind. I said, why? How did it come? I had never thought about it. I never wanted it, but there is a desire comes. That is latent desire, which is different from active desire, Duryodhana. This is Aswadhama. Aswadhama was the son of Dronacharya. Now, as I mentioned earlier, Aswadhama, one of the three Kaurava warriors who survived after the Kurukshetra war, he didn't die. He was Chiranjeevi, he lives eternally. Does it mean this latent desire is going to trouble us again and again? The latent desire was caused by unfulfilled desires. Is it going to be there? No. Guruji has given us a clue. Roast that latent desire by wisdom. When it comes up, wisdom, use wisdom. Or when a desire was unfulfilled, use wisdom and roast it. Take it away. Then you are safe. I will give one example to understand this. How to conquer unfulfilled desires. Otherwise, they might become latent desires. A child, a boy of 10-year-old, may ask for a toy car. Suppose parents did not give him a toy car. He is unhappy. His desire was not fulfilled. at the age of 12, still he has that desire. I want toy car, he was denied. And whenever he sees somebody else playing with a toy car, it pains him. It's that this desire is there. It was never fulfilled. At the age of 13, 14, still whenever he sees, that bothers him. When he becomes 20, 25, then toy car doesn't give him any trouble. He may see toy cars, but it doesn't give him any trouble. The reason is, he used his wisdom that the toy car is not going to give me happiness. Although I was denied, I was unhappy at that time, toy car is of no use. It's only temporary. For a year or two as a child, I could have used it. Now, anyway, it was denied, it's all right, leave it. Because he uses wisdom that even if then he sees a toy car, it doesn't bother him anymore. Wisdom was used to destroy, root it out from his system. So, there is no more latent desire. That is what we have to use. For instance, some people, the desires they have at the age of 15 or 20, they'll have the desire even at the age of 50 or 60. And surprising. This is not, this kind of desire is not expected in a man of 55. That was supposed to be a desire of a 15-year-old. Because he didn't roast it by wisdom. Even if he didn't have this fulfilled, it was okay, that's not going to give me any more joy. He roast it out. That's why we see sometimes in elderly people making mistake. As one grows, he has to use wisdom. What happened to Aswatthama? He didn't die because he was Chiranjeevi. But after he did the terrible act of killing Upapandavas, sons of Draupadi, five sons of Draupadi and Dushtadyumna in the dead night. No, stealthily entered the camp of Pandavas and killed them, completely wrong, completely immoral. He killed them and ran away. Then Bhim, Arjun and Krishna chased him and caught him. Then Bhagavan Krishna did not kill him. He made him powerless and allowed him to roam around powerless and friendless, all alone. That's what he is doing, Chiranjeevi. But no power, powerless and friendless. So, he was consigned to that, the powerless and friendless stage. It's okay for what you heard. So, so Aswatthama did not bother anymore the Pandavas and their children because he was powerless. Similarly, the latent desire may be there inside me, but that won't bother me. When I roast it, when I make it powerless by my wisdom, that is what we have to do with Aswatthama, the eighth warrior. So, just to recap in a minute, the warriors described in slokas 3 to 6 were identified as the spiritual soldiers ready to fight on behalf of soul forces by King Material Desire Duryodhana. Now, in slokas 7 and 8, later in 9 also, he identifies the set of warriors, the evil tendencies that are ready to help him. These are these. First, illusion, individual delusion, Krupacharya. Next, ego, Bhishma. Next, Karna, Raga, like. Attachment, then repulsion, vikarna, then somadatti, material action, jayadrata, body-bound inclination, dronacharya, habit, and finally the latent desire, aswatthama. So, let us be careful, identify them and throw them out. Like Pandavas annihilated all these seven warriors and made the eighth one powerless, we also have to win. Jai Guru, Jai Guru.